Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to Trinity Cathedral. We, as a part of our annual stewardship campaign, where we invite you to reflect on God's abundance, part of our practice is to have ministry moments where we hear from members of the congregation. This morning, we're doing it a little bit out of order. We're going to begin with a ministry moment from Brant Lee. Brant, thank you for being with us. Oh, the big eagle, of course.
So I'm Brant Lee. It's been 22 years since we've been coming to Trinity. I was baptized Episcopalian, but my home growing up was really pretty secular, because although my parents met and were married in the Episcopal Mission Church in Chinatown, they left before I remember. They told me later that they saw too much hypocrisy. And then when I was a teenager, I fell in with a fundamentalist youth group who I desperately escaped before college. And the only reason I'm telling you that part is that when I came to church with Marie, it was with intention, right? Not because of a habit or a custom or a tradition. And so it's still the case that words like sin or savior or even prayer, right? They don't fall off the tip of my tongue. They're not sort of baked into my bones from when I was growing up. Or even the word stewardship. So why do we give to Trinity? Why do we even come to Trinity? Honestly, I come partly because it's something Marie and I do together. And I come because there's a community of kind, loving people who watch my kids grow up. And because this is a place that's engaged with the broader community, that looks outward, right, that has been a public voice on important issues of the day. But this is not a transaction, right? There's so much in our world that is transactional. There's so many times when we are taught to ask, what is this worth, right? Why should I pay for this? What am I getting out of it? What's in it for me? So I'm not purchasing something, right? Not paying an entrance fee for a spiritual amusement park, although it has been a ride, sometimes with thrills, and occasionally I eat too many sweet things. But for me, Trinity is a place where I can focus at least once a week on how to be a better person, how to participate in creating a better world, how to understand our place in the universe, and how to pay attention to both joy and despair in others and in ourselves. When I reached a point in my life trying to do it all on my own, when I reached what is called a bottom, right, and I thought that I might lose everything, it was here at Trinity that I learned how to let go and how to hear God's voice. I give to Trinity because I belong here. I met God here. I am a part of it. It is a part of me. And if it is a part of you, or if you would like to join and be a part of it, then I ask you to give generously as well.
Blessed be the one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. God be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord, your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that your Lord God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountains smoking. They were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance and said to Moses, "You speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of him upon you so that you do not do sin." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Then God spoke, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenant seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Are you bored with being so proper? Do you want to have more fun? Mr. Tiger knows exactly how you feel. So he decides to go wild. So begins my favorite children's book, Mr. Tiger Goes Wild by Peter Brown. I think it's fairly recent. I read it first as an adult. I can't begin to do justice in telling the story without the illustrations, and I'm not going to do the full kind of Sunday, nursery school walk through the book. But I do want you to at least have an image of the iconography with which I am working this morning. You can see Mr. Tiger. He is properly dressed in top hat and tails. We'll put that right here so that you can see it. It's the story of a very proper tiger who dresses in coat and tie, just like all the other village animals, and who walks upright and sips his tea and appropriately and does everything as his society demands. Everyone was perfectly fine with the way things were. Everyone but Mr. Tiger. He wanted to loosen up. He wanted to have fun. He wanted to be wild. He begins with a simple change in posture, dropping to all fours and then running about as tigers are supposed to do. Now, though he kept his top hat and his dress jacket and his bow tie perfectly arranged, Mr. Tiger became wilder and wilder every day, even letting out an occasional roar until the day when Mr. Tiger went a little too far. He jumped into a fountain in the center of the city and emerged without his clothes, not a stitch of clothing on, though he was in his resplendent black and orange tiger coat. Some pretty good baptismal imagery, but I'll save that one for another day. It felt just right to Mr. Tiger. This was freedom, but not to the other animals, who said, "Mr. Tiger, if you must act wild, kindly do so in the wilderness." To which he replied, "What a magnificent idea," and off he ran. Now, if you wanted something wild, you would have shown up at 9 o'clock today when animals, dogs, cats, all kinds of things, as well as a number of screenshots of animals, were all blessed. It was a zoo. It was wonderful. We were celebrating St. Francis at the blessing of the animals. And St. Francis had a similar origin story to Mr. Tiger. But before we get to the place where Francis, too, stripped off his clothes and ran into the wilderness to go wild, if you will, let's look a bit at his backstory. Lesser Feasts and Fasts had a pretty good insight on him when they wrote, "Francis is perhaps the most popular and admired of all the saints, but probably the least imitated. Few have attained to his total identification with the poverty and suffering of Christ." To understand Francis, to get to know who this wild man really was, we have to look past the ways that over the centuries we have domesticated him and made him precious. We know him as the lover of animals, the lover of nature, as a friend to the poor, as a channel of peace, and the prophet of Brother Sun, with whom we would all love to share a pumpkin spice latte. He is all of the, well, he's most of those things. He's not all of those things. But his message to us is far more radical than I'll bet many of us realize. Francis grew up in a violent time. It was one of disruption. It was one of economic change. It was in late 12th century Europe when the feudal agrarian world was giving way to city-states, where a mercantile economy made some people fabulously wealthy, while many others simply grew farther and farther away from prosperity. The division between those that had and those that had not was growing ever wider. As this mercantile economy grew, those tradesmen, those they couldn't get into the guilds. So many people suffered. Many people starved. Banking was emerging as a force. Sure, that made some things possible, but it also meant money was flowing, but big interest was being charged as well. And so in this, cloth merchants, such as Pietro de Bernardone, made a killing. This was a time when clothes made the man and money was, cash was flowing. And so there was a fortune to be had. That was Francis's father, by the way. So Francis grew up living what he thought was his best life. So every night, Francis would go out with his boys, with his crew, and they'd go out, they'd have a fine, sumptuous dinner. They would drink a whole lot of wine, and then they would, according to legend, commit all possibilities of debauchery. And at the end of every night, who picked up the tab? Francis. Because Francis was loaded. This was like that old show Entourage, where everybody sort of followed the movie star. And you know, he thought that he was living the wild life. But of course, he wasn't. And in 1202, when Francis was 21, he went to war When Assisi went up against Perugia, Francis was eager for glory, but things did not go his way. They lost the battle. Francis was kidnapped, and then he spent the next year in a dark dungeon. Imagine the contrast from going from being at the top of the world, having all the money, all the clothes, all the food, to suddenly having to be in a dark dungeon for a whole year. This was nothing short of traumatic, and it changed him. I think we all know that trauma can change us. Sometimes our lives are disrupted, and we lose everything that we thought was essential to who we are. We lose everything we thought made us who we are, but then we come out the other side, and when we do, the things that were all the rage no longer make a bit of sense. And right after being released, Francis found, I think it was an old abandoned church, but it was a church, and he just crawled into it, and he slept for days. And he prayed for days. And when he came out of that church, he had changed. And when he emerged from that church, he emerged with something new. He emerged with a vision of freedom. And then Francis went wild, truly wild. I don't mean the performative wildness of debauchery. That's just domestication by another name. But the wildness of someone who has been caught up in God's love, someone who has caught the scent of true freedom and can only chase after it with his or her whole being. Francis then renounced his wealth. He renounced his family name. He threw off his clothes, literally stripping naked, just as Mr. Tiger did in the fountain in the middle of town. And then he goes off into the wilderness. Now, not the faraway woods, but rather he found, right by the town where he was, a leper colony. And there he found a community of folk who had nothing, who were truly untouchable, who were cast aside. People were afraid of them. And Francis saw in them, Francis embraced it, literally embraced them. The one thing you don't do to someone with that disease is what Francis did. And he saw in them, in these folk who had nothing, he saw the people who were beloved of God and who were embraced by God's ravishing love. Francis then didn't just take on poverty as a spiritual practice. He fell in love with it. He fell in love with it, with the total gratitude of it, with the sheer reliance on God's goodness and mercy. Francis went wild. He discovered that fine wines and sumptuous clothes had not made him happy or free. Great wealth and the status of being able to pick up the tab whenever he wants, or the privilege of committing all manner of debauchery but not being called out for it, that didn't make him happy or free. Going to battle, violence had not made him happy or free, but Francis looked at all this, and he began to connect the dots and to realize that the violence of warfare and the sumptuousness of the material goods that made him the rich kid had a particular relationship with one another, and it all conspired to keep him from being truly free and from keeping all of those who it touched from discovering this freedom as well. And Francis cast all that off because he found that his joy was not in glory or in stuff, but in those things that sparked his gratitude. Brother Sun and Sister Moon were gifts of the Creator that filled him with gratitude. He was humbled and filled with gratitude to imagine that God would make him, little Francis, a channel of peace and an instrument of understanding. Even poverty filled him with gratitude because it meant that every day he could thank God for what came to him in that moment. It was all giftedness. Francis had discovered that gratitude is the pathway to freedom. Gratitude is the pathway to freedom. Francis, though, had a new crowd of people who were following him. Not a rowdy crew who simply wanted to be near the guy picking up the tab, but rather those who saw in Francis something special, and they wanted to be a part of it. To be a mendicant who walked with Francis, though, brothers had to do something. They had to give up everything. They couldn't hold on to anything from their old lives. This was to embrace the poverty that would forge in them a daily gratitude. It was so that they could share in the sufferings of Christ and to be in solidarity with those poor folks who didn't have the choice to say, I'm going to live this life. That was just their lot. Yet there was a deeper reason. And this is where we see just how radical Francis of Assisi really was. Francis's insight was that property, by creating envy and conflict, was the one thing most destructive to peace in the world. Having property, he believed, meant having arms for its defense. It meant having standing armies. It meant blood feuds that we say are about honor and freedom, but are really, to his mind, about the preservation of property, but also the preservation of poverty, because he noticed that while some people did just fine when nations collided, what really tended to happen is that the poor just got poorer, and those without, and stayed on the outside. Is that not radical? I mean, can you see that one being a center platform of any political party, especially kind of the major ones? No, not at all. That's how far from many of our common understandings this vision of freedom and gratitude really can be. Francis believed that property and wealth and status and violence were all bound up together. He believed that poverty and solidarity with Christ and with the poor, and a life of profound gratitude were the only antidotes to that. He did believe that the natural world was a gift from God. He did love animals. He did love creation. He believed all these things, and he held them together through his own suffering, but through his joy as well, with a smile that always reflected a deeper and unshakable love for all that God had created. He did this. The reason why we love Francis, the reason why we know everything that Francis did, is because he was so filled with joy, and it just infused the world all around him. When Francis came to town, it was the big show. People showed up. People did not miss that. He was courteous, he was genial, he was extroverted, he was fun. While preaching, he often danced, he would weep, he would make animal sounds, he would strip down to his underwear sometimes, he would even play the zither. I have good news for you. I do not own a zither. I make no promises about the other ones. And that is why we remember him. If Francis was just another rich kid who got religion, his insights on property and violence and even gratitude might have faded with him. But what endured was his sense of joy and his love for all of God's creation that was rooted in a gratitude that infused his whole being. Francis had gone wild. He had found freedom and become a channel for sharing it with each and every one of us, so that we might know that God's gift to all of us is freedom, and that the pathway to that freedom is gratitude.
Together, let us profess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
For our deepest and most holy longings, we pray.
Renew us, O God.
For all who wander, who hunger, who thirst,
renew us as people of service and compassion.
For this planet, our home,
renew our will to the healers of creation.
For this and every nation,
renew in all people the will for good and the longing for peace.
For those whom we hold in our hearts, especially Mary, Sue, Karen, Paul, Tony, Charlotte, Deborah, Lori, Jim, Nancy, Laura, Tim, Stuart, Tanya, David, Stuart, Leslie, and Mary. We pray for loved ones who have recently died and for their families, especially Tim McCoot. We pray for U.S. military personnel and for their families. We pray for our companions in the Diocese of Belize and the Diocese of Tanga, Tanzania. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Paul's Church, Cleveland Heights, Church of the Ascension, Lakewood, St. Peter's Church, Lakewood. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the churches in the Diocese of Algoma, Canada. We continue to pray for the health of our presiding bishop, Michael B. Curry. We pray for the volunteers who serve on the committees of the vestry, supporting the cathedral in all matters of finance, property, and personnel. We pray for our LGBTQ+ siblings in Christ in Cleveland, whose churches, schools, and workplaces limit the full expression of who you created them to be. May your church, O God, honor the dignity of every human being. We offer blessings to Carla Rivers and Mike Graska, who are celebrating their 35th wedding anniversary. We offer blessings upon those celebrating birthdays this week: Tom Austin, Gert Bauer, Walter Bruckner, Marie Curry, and Nick Vilfoy. Bless these and all creation with your goodness, and renew our trust in your love. Amen.
We pray also for those who suffer violence in Gaza and Ukraine and elsewhere through wars throughout the world. Accept the fervent prayers of your people, O God, and the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us all and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, blessed Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. Peace.
Good morning once again, and peace be with you. Excuse me, let me be the first to tell you, good afternoon, and peace be with you. A word of gratitude to Brant Lee for sharing a bit of his story with us earlier. He had to be out a little bit earlier for another commitment, which is why we started with that. A reminder, we are in the midst of our stewardship season, and I invite you to consider prayerfully how you can continue to support the life of Trinity, but most importantly, how through your pledge, you can explore the life of gratitude. If you've never pledged before, I hope you'll consider doing so. If this is something you do, I hope you'll consider growing in your pledge as you're able to do that. We will be continuing this for a few more weeks. And October 28th, we'll have a harvest dinner and hymn sing on Saturday. It's a Saturday evening at 4 o'clock. And then we celebrate the conclusion of our campaign on October 29th, that's a Sunday. This, we offer Catherine Smythe Zeitz our prayers as she heads to Columbus today to participate in a vigil of faith leaders in opposition to the death penalty. So I ask that you hold that in your prayers and hold Catherine, who is the leader of Episcopal Peace Fellowship here at Trinity. And this coming week is a big week. Becca Stevens is going to be with us. Becca Stevens created, more than two decades ago, created Thistle Farms in Nashville as a way of bringing women who are suffering under addiction, trafficking, and prostitution out of that to help heal their body, their mind, and their spirit, and to also help to give them work so that they can have economic freedom. She created that, and it is a movement that continues in Nashville and has grown to be a worldwide movement of liberation. She is an Episcopal priest. She's going to be with us Wednesday evening for Evensong. She'll preach that. And then a community forum here at Trinity at 7 p.m. That's open to people from churches and communities all around. And then she'll be here on Sunday morning, both preaching at both the 9 and the 11:15 service and offering a forum. I'll be with her between the two services. And at all of these events, she's traveling with graduates of the program who will be a part of the forum, who have themselves become leaders in this movement of freedom and liberation. So always come to church on Sunday, but especially come to church next Sunday, because it's really going to be a special event, both Wednesday and Sunday. And don't forget, do some of your Christmas shopping, because they bring some of the health and wellness products that they create, and that's a big part of how they finance this wonderful ministry and movement. Is anybody celebrating a birthday or anniversary this Sunday? Please, if you'd like to come forward, I invite you to do so. And then I look in your direction until you actually do, but you don't have to. I'll find a way to play it cool if you don't want to. Christian, what day is your birthday? Today, happy birthday. We're so glad you're here with us this morning. Yes, I agree. Christian, the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Christian as he begins another year. Grant that he may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen his trust in your goodness all the days of his life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Happy birthday, Christian. So everybody say hello to him and happy birthday after church. If you are joining us for the first time or one of your first times, we welcome you. We are so glad you're here. You'll find at the base of many of the pillars as well as entrances information about Trinity, a newcomer card. If you'd like, you can fill that out, drop it in a plate or hand it to one of us so that we can follow up with you. If you're online, you'll see much of the same information up at the top. And we have a newcomer brunch later this month. Is it the 29th? Who can tell me?
Yes.
That sounds right. It's the 29th. Yes, thank you. So if you're new in the last year or so, and you've never been a part of that, let me know, let Adrienne or Ginger Bitterkofer know. We'd love to have you join us and welcome you to Trinity. We're so glad that you're here. Blessings to all of you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Please stand. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have been.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race, and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another. Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. And so, Almighty God, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, Lord God of our ancestors, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Accept these prayers and praises, O God, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
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 And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God of promise, you have prepared a banquet for us. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Please stand and join me in the post-communion prayer. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. May the light of the Holy Spirit shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the face of Christ turn towards you and give you peace. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
better than that.